Hello and welcome to the second video on the first atom bomb. In this video, we'll get to know more about Marcel Junot's experiences in Hiroshima. Junot begins his narration by talking about how people outside Hiroshima and Nagasaki knew practically nothing about the fate of the devastated towns or of the innumerable victims after the dropping of the two atomic bombs. Even though the American wireless had broadcast a very great deal about the preparations made for the use of the new weapon and about the extraordinary power of the weapon, after the bombardment, nothing was known about it to the rest of the world. And the only thing that the world knew was the prophecy that for 70 years at least, the radioactivity of the earth around the scene of explosion will prevent all forms of life from existing there. Junot says the Americans he met on board of ISS Benevolence, the American hospital ship, fell silent the moment he talked about Hiroshima. There was an indefinable sense of discomfort to them to talk about this particular place. For a different reason, Japanese also maintained complete silence about Hiroshima, partially because, maybe because it was followed by the defeat of Japan. So no official report was there regarding the impact of the bombings. Only verbal reports that went from one end of Japan to another gave some idea about what was the kind of impact, the sudden cataclysm that meant to the, what it meant to the inhabitants of Hiroshima. For example, one of the secretaries in ICRC, a half Japanese, repeated a story which was rumored amongst the Japanese that many fugitives had fled from Hiroshima to seek safety of their families. They had left Hiroshima to some other places. Those people actually described this. It was like a profoundly disquieting description. It was such a horrible thing. The blinding light suddenly flashing out of peaceful sky, and it was a phenomenon much more terrible than an earthquake. It was a typhoon of glare, heat and wind, which had swept suddenly over the earth and left a sea of fire behind it. No one actually knew the total number of dead. Some said it was 50,000, some said 200,000. And those who first seemed to have escaped the injury, they were dying every day with strange new inexplicable symptoms. So these were not official records, these were word of mouth. Actually, people were talking about it. This was the only thing people knew about Hiroshima. The real record of what happened in Hiroshima came from a telegram. The telegram was sent by Fritz Bilfinger was an ICRC delegate in Japan in 1945. He was the first foreign Red Cross worker on the ground of Hiroshima. His telegram actually made a lot of difference in the way people looked at Hiroshima. On 2nd September, a Japanese policeman brought a copy of a telegram to the villa where Junot lived. This person had arrived in Hiroshima on 30th August. And when he reached there, he sent this telegram. It said like this. You can see the picture of the telegram on the screen. And here is the picture of Bilfinger also. Situation horrifying, 90% of town razed, all hospitals destroyed or severely damaged. Have visited two provisional hospitals, conditions indescribable. Bomb effects mysterious. Many victims apparently recovering suddenly experience fatal relapse owing to degeneration of white corpuscles and other internal injuries. Deaths still occurring in great numbers, more than 100,000 victims still in provisional hospitals in neighborhood. Grave shortage of material, bandages, medicaments. Appeal allied high command supplies to be parachuted immediately into center of town. Urgently need large supplies of bandages, cotton wool, ointments for burns, sulfamides, blood plasma and transfusion kits. Immediate action necessary. Getting this particular telegram, what Junod did was he took the telegram and the photograph sent by Bill Finger of the calamities that was around. He actually took it to Yokohama Chamber of Commerce. There was where General MacArthur had set up his office. He was in charge of Japan actually. He was a military official who was in charge of Japan. So when he reached there, the people that he met were General Fitch, who was the chief of US Information Service, Colonel Marcus, who was a prisoners of war department staff or authority, Colonel Webster, who was chief of the hospital service, Colonel Sams, who was in charge of assistance for the civil population. They were the first American to see the photographs of Hiroshima. So he showed this. He had shown these pictures to them, and their faces were grave and attentive. No one spoke. The photos went from one hand to another. After a while, they asked, "What do you want us to do?" Junod was actually not expecting this kind of question. What did I want them to do? Wasn't Bill Finger's telegram plain enough? There were 100,000 wounded people without proper attention. Bandages, sulfamides, blood plasma. He had listed it all in the telegram. And still these people are asking, what do you want us to do? The general turned to Colonel Sams. That's your department, I think, he said. The four officers put their heads together. Then one of them picked up the photos and the telegram. Leave these with me. I want to show them to General MacArthur. It was on 7th September that he got a call from Colonel Sams. He asked him to go to Yokohama, and there he was asked to join the commission of inquiry which was leaving for Hiroshima, and they offered to help, not from the part of the army. The army won't be actually distributing these materials. The army asked ICRC to take up the responsibility. Thus, Junod went to Hiroshima with the commission of inquiry. And on 9th September, he reached, on 9th September, he left the island of Miyajima, and from their hotel, they walked along the shore to the little harbor. They boarded a boat which was to take us over the arm of the sea, which separated them from the mainland. So from there he was traveling on in a car, and he had two Japanese interpreters with him. One was Miss Ito. She was born in Canada, and a Japanese journalist was the other person who had spent 20 years in the United States. So these people were interpreting Japanese to Marcel Junod. What these people first did was they gave him an idea about what Hiroshima was at a time. He needed their accounts in order to compare the reality of yesterday. He didn't know what exactly Hiroshima was before he came there, before the atom bombs were dropped. So these people helped him to understand that. Miss Ito told that Hiroshima meant the broad island. It was the seventh town in point of size in Japan. It was built on River Ota. You can see the picture of River Ota at the time of the atom bomb dropping. The seven tributaries of the River Ota are known as seven arms of Ota, and they make a perfect triangle. They enclose into a perfect triangle to form the harbor of the town. It was a town with factories, oil refineries and warehouses. The river actually originated from Mount Kanmuri. The population was 250,000 people, and in addition there was a garrison of a group of soldiers, of 150,000 soldiers there. The journalist described the day of the atomic bombing. It was August 6th, and there wasn't a cloud in the sky of above Hiroshima, and a mild, hardly perceptible wind blew from the south. Visibility was almost perfect for 10 or 12 miles. At 10 minutes past 7 in the morning, an air raid warning sounded and four American B-29 planes appeared. To the north of the town, two of them turned and made off to the south and disappeared in the direction of Shohoshi, and the other two, after having circled the neighborhood of Shukai, flew off at high speed southwards in the direction of Bingoshi. So the four planes came and went, and people believed that that was a usual air raid. At 7:31, the all clear was given. Feeling themselves in safety, people came out of their shelters and went about their affairs, and the work of the day began. Suddenly, a glaring whitish-pinkish light appeared in the sky, accompanied by an unnatural tremor, which was followed almost immediately by a wave of suffocating heat and wind, which swept away everything in its path. Within a few seconds, of the thousands of people in the streets and the gardens in the center of the town were scorched by a wave of searing heat. Many were killed instantly, others lay writhing in the ground, screaming in agony from the intolerable pain of their burns. Everything standing upright in the way of the blast, walls, houses, factories, and other buildings, was annihilated. And the debris spun around in a whirlwind and was carried up into the air. Trams were picked up and tossed aside as though they had neither weight nor solidity. Trains were flung off the rails as though they were toys. Horses, dogs, and cattle suffered the same fate as human beings. Every living thing was petrified in the attitude of indescribable suffering. Even the vegetation did not escape. Trees went up in flames. The rice plants lost their greenness. The grass burned on the ground like dry straw. Beyond the zone of utter death in which nothing remained alive, houses collapsed in a whirl of beams, bricks and girders. Up to about 3 miles from the center of explosion, lightly built houses were flattened as though they had been built of cardboard. Those who were inside were either killed or wounded. Those who managed to extricate themselves by some miracle found themselves surrounded by a ring of fire. And the few who succeeded in making their way to safety generally died 20 or 30 days later from delayed effects of the deadly gamma rays. Some of the reinforced concrete or stone buildings remained standing, but their interiors were completely gutted by the blast. About half an hour after the explosion, whilst the sky all round Hiroshima was still cloudless, a fine rain began to fall on the town and went on for about 5 minutes. It was caused by the sudden rise of overheated air to the great height, where it condensed and fell back as rain. Then a violent wind rose, and the fires extended with terrible rapidity, because most Japanese houses are built only of timber and straw. By the evening, the fire began to die down, and then it went out. There was nothing left to burn. Hiroshima had ceased to exist. Talking about this experience, the Japanese suddenly, abruptly, they stopped. And when he looked out, they could see about 2.5 miles from the center of the town, all the buildings had been burnt out and destroyed. Only traces of foundations and piles of debris and rusty charred ironwork were left. 3/4 of a mile from the center of explosion, nothing at all was left. Everything had disappeared. It was a stony waste littered with debris and twisted girders. And when they got out of the car, they met, actually, there is an episode of meeting Professor Suzuki. Here is a picture of Professor Suzuki. He was one of the leading surgeons in Japan. He led the way and talked about what happened to the hospital. "We must open our minds. We must try to understand everything." He pointed to the remnants of a wall, the base of which ran for perhaps 6 or 7 yards. "There was a hospital here, gentlemen. 200 beds, 8 doctors, 20 nurses. Every single one, all the patients were killed. That's what an atomic bomb does." A few days before Junod left Tokyo, Brigadier General Baker, one of the American officers in charge of foreign relations, informed Junod that General MacArthur wished to receive the delegation of the International Red Cross. And when they went there to his office on the top floor of the building, he was wearing the ordinary service uniform of the U.S. Army. Let's see who this person was. General MacArthur was, his full name was Douglas MacArthur. He was born on 26 January 1880 and he died on 5th April 1964. He was an American 5-star general and field marshal of the Philippines Army. He was the chief of staff of the United States Army during the 1930s and played a prominent role in the Pacific theater during the World War II. So he was actually someone who really played an important role in the victory of America in Japan. You can see his picture here. Junod says that he was in a normal uniform with the traditional pipe. You can see in his mouth the traditional pipe that he usually has. He was wearing an ordinary uniform. Only the 5 stars on his shoulder told about his position in the army. He thanked them for the work they had done on behalf of the imprisoned Americans in Japan. He was talking about it, but Junod was feeling that he wanted to tell something more. We could feel that his thoughts went even further than the fate of his own men. He was thinking of everyone who had been assisted and protected by the Red Cross. All those who, in their exile and their humiliation, had no other hope of assistance. So, Red Cross was doing such a great job there. The supreme value of human life and human blood has been forgotten, he said, and human dignity too. He's talking about American bombing of Hiroshima. In a firm voice, emphasizing each word, he went on, force is not a solution for man's problems. Force on its own is nothing. It never has the last word. Perhaps you find it strange that I, a professional soldier, should say that to you. The chief architect of victory in the Pacific did not conceal his opinion that peace still lay far ahead in the future. Even with our present weapons, he went on, not including those still to be developed, a new war would leave nothing behind worthy of mention. Even though he was a soldier, he felt that all wars were actually worthless. And even more precise terms, he sketched the danger of death and destruction which still hung over the world. Too much has been destroyed in the war, and the physical exhaustion is still great for there to be another war during the next 20 or 25 years. But what will happen after that? What will happen unless between now and then we do everything possible to save mankind from itself? So what you see in the picture is the Hiroshima Peace Memorial or Hiroshima Prefectural Industrial Promotion Hall. It was that. Later it was called the Atomic Bomb Dome. It is a part of Hiroshima Peace Memorial Park in Hiroshima. It was considered to be a World Heritage Site in 1996 by UNESCO. This building serves as a memorial to the to over 140,000 people who were killed in the atomic bombing of Hiroshima on 6th August 1945. So the chapter concludes talking about how the war actually left a lot of physical exhaustion, and there won't be any war for next 20 or 25 years. That's what people at that point of time, that's what they felt. And they say that what will happen after that? People have to try really hard to prevent a war. If they don't do that, if there is another war, we can't predict what is going to happen. That doubt, that particular concern is still relevant. With that note, let's wind up the lesson. Thank you for listening. This glossary actually is from the chapter. I think this can help you to read it in a better way. Please look at it.